Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, somebody. We are live again, and we give the Lord thanks for this opportunity that He affords us to be here. So let me thank God for you. Amen. And as we go forth, thank you. Going to be playing some more music as we wait for the others to join with us as usual. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Sister Joan, I hope you're hearing me loud and clear tonight, because I should be loud and clear. So you could put it in there if you hear me loud and clear. Type in there loud and clear, so you hear me loud and clear. From what I'm seeing on my side, I should be very, very loud as it relates to my mic. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you. God. All right, we wait a minute or two more with another song. Praise the name of the Lord. We are at 5 persons. So we just wait a little bit. Play another song and wait a little bit. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God. At 9. Biblical understanding of first fruits, and we're going to go to tithe. Persons are familiar with those two, mainly tithe, so we're going to go over from scratch. Last week we had a difficult time with the sound and the things. Internet went right down as well. Praise God. Should start in the next minute. This thing should be finished in a minute. Praise God. Should be about it for that song, that track. It's almost there. So we go into this as usual. We thank the Lord for that musical item, those two musical items, as we get ready now to just pray and get started. So welcome again. Let us just pray as we get ready to start. Father, we thank you. Lord God, we lift you high. There is none like you, Lord. Lord, there is none like you, and we want to acknowledge your goodness. Lord, we pray as we study together that you remove from us the ignorance and blindness, that God will cause us to have hardness of heart, but that in spirit and in truth through the Holy Spirit, you will lead us into the right attitude and the right posture and the right way how to give and give to your cause, give to the kingdom at this time. Bless our time together, we pray. We pray for our smooth transition on the air. We pray for our brothers and sisters listening and those who will be listening at a later time, that each listener will receive, Lord, information that will transform his or her life to the glory of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Yes, so we give the Lord thanks as we welcome you to share with us and to be on this link with us. Amen. So we are going to be studying the biblical understanding of first fruit and the tithe, and whatever else we can cover under that. So we lay the foundation already. It comes under the broad foundation of offerings and sacrifices that were given in the Old Testament, We said, draw near, go up, amen, Carban, Ola, Minka, draw near, go up, and give your tribute. So all of the offerings in the Old Testament centers around, draw near, go up, present your tribute. And when we sin, they offered trespass offering and sin offering to make things right with the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. So here we go now. We have these to look at. First fruit, and we want to look at it as best as we can. So the first thing I want to lay out for us is that first fruit has two main things to it. There is a first fruit feast of first fruit, and there is first fruit on a regular general basis. So the feast of first fruit, and then you have first fruit right around here. So we're going to start with the feast of first fruit first, but I want to spend some time to explain what the biblical context of first fruit is. Let's look at that. To do so, I have to remind you and remind myself that in the Bible days, in the Old Testament times, coming down into the New Testament, the people lived in what is called agricultural or farming society. The main two things that were done in biblical times for living is farming and fishing, and in the Old Testament coming down we have persons who do hunting. But the two major things that were done for people to live and to survive is farming and fishing, and by extension some persons were doing hunting. But in the Old and New Testament, the major way of making a living in that time is through farming and fishing. People hunt now and here and there, like Esau, here and there, through there. But the main thing is that once you are going to survive in the Old Testament economy, you must have land that you can farm. And on the land, you must have somewhere that you can raise your cattle, your cow, amen, your goat, your sheep, your ox, and those kind of animals that were able to be eaten. And on the farm, you will also have some persons who, along the way, for war and other things, you have camel for travel, and you have horses for war, you have donkeys to carry the produce from the farm area to the storage area and to go through the desert at different places and different times. We have what is called the mule, or the vehicle of the desert time. Now, first fruit is agricultural, and we must understand it in the agricultural sense of the word. And therefore, I'm going to play this, which we did last week, that I believe you would have listened to it, and if you got the chance, you would have looked for the video yourself. So I'm going to play it again about first fruit, because the laws that govern first fruit are in the Old Testament, clearly laid out. And I want to put it to those of us who farm, that if it is possible, that you can try this and to see what God will do for you if you follow exactly what God says to do, and it relates to the land and planting the land and reaping the land and to give first fruit. All right, just waiting on this thing to come up. It should have been up, but these things have a time to delay us. All right, so let's listen to this 1 minute and 12 seconds again. This gentleman tried it and the Lord blessed him. So let's hear his testimony one more time about obedience to God. And what happened? It's amazing that this gentleman that we are going to listen to is not living in the Bible times of Old Testament. He's living in New Testament time. And he read about first fruit and he took it up. And this is what happened. Taking too long to play. Come on. Answer now. Alright, so in the meantime, while we look at this, wait on this, we go to Leviticus 23. Leviticus 23. That's where we're going to start the scriptures in Leviticus 23. All right. Leviticus 23. All right. Still telling me to wait. All right. So let's run to Leviticus 23. And maybe while we are going there, it will start to play for us. Leviticus 23. All right. Leviticus 23. Return there. Leviticus 23. Verse 10. Leviticus 23 from verse 10. All right. We are getting there. So Leviticus 23 from verse 10. To God be the glory. All right. So in Leviticus 23, we have the seven feast appointment of the Lord. We dealt with them when we were looking at prophecy and how prophecy came to pass, we studied that already. So Leviticus 23 is where we're going. I'm going there for one main reason, and it is the feast of first fruits. That is in verses 10 down to 15. 14. Leviticus 23, 10 to 14. We are going to pull that up. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. All right. Leviticus 23. So let us read until it comes up. This one here, I'm still checking it for you because it should play without giving me any issue at all. I tell you. All right, so let me do something else with it. All right, so let that go on to work. So Leviticus 23 from verse 10. Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when ye come into the land which I give unto you, and shall reap the harvest thereof, then ye shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest unto the priest. A sheaf of your first fruit of your harvest unto the priest. And he shall wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted for you. And the morrow after the Sabbath the priest shall wave it. And he shall offer that day when he wave the sheaf and he lamb without blemish of the first year for a burnt offering unto the Lord. And the meat offering thereof shall be 2/10 deals of fine flour mingled with oil, an offering made by fire unto the Lord for a sweet savour. And the drink offering thereof shall be of wine, the fourth part of an hin. Look at verse 14 now, that carries a very, very important instruction that we ought not to ignore. And ye shall eat neither bread, nor parched corn, nor green ears, until the selfsame day that ye have brought an offering unto your God. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings. God says, this offering that is called the first fruit offering, you must not eat any of it or any of the crop, whether it is bread, parched corn, new ears, you have to give God the first fruit first. God said, give me that which is mine first. And after he received that, then he will bless the rest, because the first fruit represents the rest. All right? But remember now, we're talking about the agriculture. So in Leviticus 23, what we are finding is that the feast of first fruit. So remember what I said, you know, there are two things. The regular first fruit and the feast of first fruit. The feast of first fruit comes once a year. Once a year. That is one of the reasons why some churches, they go for the beginning of the year, January, on our calendar, and they emphasize first fruit offering and giving. All right? However, this first fruit feast here is on the first month of the year and the 17th of the month. Most likely, after Passover, you have Passover, then unleavened bread, the 15th, and 3 days and three nights after that, you have, by the 17th, you have the feast of first fruit. Now, let's look at it. So, first fruit as a feast, it comes once per year. This thing loading long indeed. Interesting to note. Amen. Interesting to note. So, if you are going to give first fruit the time that God specifies it, you will have to move from the January system and to what we call Easter Sunday. So let's go. What we call Easter Sunday, according to the calendar I'm reading from, is first fruit. That's why we tell you before that Easter is not biblical. First fruit is biblical. Passover is biblical. First fruit is biblical. So the day that we hear about Easter, which is the Babylonian god and pagan god and so on, they put that name on the feast of first fruit. And that's why we sometimes can't understand the Bible, because the things we do know sometimes don't have any direct relationship to the biblical account of the things. So let's that be clear in our mind. So the feast of first fruit comes every year for us on what we will call Easter Sunday. So Passover will be the crucifixion, unleavened bread will be the burial, and first fruit will be the resurrection. So we tell you now that the first fruit feast is a type and shadow of the death of Christ, the Passover lamb, the burial of Christ, the unleavened bread and the baked lamb, and the resurrection of Christ, the coming from the grave. So God said it must be done when? On the morrow after the Sabbath. And the what? Morrow after the Sabbath. It must be brought to the priest ahead of time, and the priest is to prepare it, and on the morning it should be waved before God. That is why Jesus, when he came from the dead, because the first fruit depicting Jesus. So I'm trying my best not to go too far in the prophetic of it, but you can't teach this and ignore the prophetic. So when Christ came from the grave and was walking that first day of the week, and Mary came to touch him, he said, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended. Because he wait until the morrow after the Sabbath, when the first fruit shall be waved. Now remember now, first fruit and the, in the field is a type and shadow of believers. When the harvest, remember the wheat and tares grow together until harvest, so the crops represent people. So when the first fruit is reaped, which is people, when Christ came from the dead, those persons who came out of the grave were among the first fruit of those who will be resurrected. And Christ, when he ascended to heaven, he took those persons with him and present them to the Father. And say to the Father, Father, these are a sample, the first fruit of those who will believe and will be raised in the last days. That's the understanding of first fruit from Old into New Testament. But I'm going to do some further study on it now. All right. So let me find something here so for you. All right. That I can play that video for you. All right. I'm going to play it for you so that you can listen to this gentleman in our time. He was reading the Bible and he decided that, hey, I am going to try out this first fruit thing on my farm. And he got an amazing result. Very much amazing. And I want to play it for you. The title of the video, When Life Gives You Lemons, Make Sure You Tithe. That's how it is tied. So here we go now. Listen to this gentleman, and as we learn. So here we go now. Where is it? Good. Praise God. This is silent. I tell you, should be playing long time, you know. I tell you. All right, so it will play. What you're asking me again to wait? These things are interesting, but very interesting. All right, so. Let's go now in your Bibles while we wait on this to Genesis chapter 4. I'm going to trace some of the main passages about first fruit in the Old Testament come right round. So the first mention of the issue is in Genesis 4 with Cain and Abel. And we want to see what happened there and to learn from the incident. Genesis chapter 4. The Bible says Adam and Eve, they had two sons. One was, and again, Abel was a keeper of sheep, verse 2, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. In the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. That's where we find some problem. And you know what happened after that? Cain got vexed with God and took out his anger on his brother. Cain got angry with God and took it out on his brother. Of course, he was angry with his brother as well, because it seemed like his brother found some secret that he used to get accepted by God, and then he didn't know the secret. And what he did is to kill his brother. So, remember now. This look like we're having some better hope. So, all right, let's go now. Should be playing in any time now. Loading, good. Loading, all Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, good. There we go.
Eight years ago, I planted the lemon tree in my yard. And we were reading the Old Testament. And what it says is the first 3 years, you're not to harvest the crop. But the fourth year, you harvest the crop, and then you give the first fruits to God. Now the fourth year on that lemon tree had 12 lemons. So I took the best lemon, and I washed it, and I took my pen, and I wrote first fruits on that lemon. And I took it to church on Sunday, and I dropped it in the offering. Okay, now 4 years later, our other tree still produces regular sized lemons. But the tree we tithed on now produces only this size lemons. It doesn't produce any medium size or small lemons. It only produces these. God's word is true. Man, he says that he'll give you the desire to obey him and the power to do what pleases him. And man, this is just a result of obedience. Man, try and see.
That's good. That is very good. So, this gentleman is not ancient ago, or many years ago. It's a modern gentleman we are talking about here, that he put God to the test. And he got the results that he wanted overwhelmingly. So, if we are willing to follow what God said, I believe that if we do that, so those of us who do farming, maybe one of them years you have to try something like this and just see what happens. Just read the scriptures and try it. Look at what that man is getting. Said so that tree that him gave first fruit on, the way God told us to do it, and then tithe. That tree only produced that size lemon. Very interesting. So, back to Genesis 4 now. So, we go into something special. So, watch me now. Abel knew by revelation or instruction from God or from his father or parents, Adam, that these are supposed to be done. Remember now, we gave 5 offerings. Cain offering had nothing in there for sin. There wasn't any offering that was there for sin in Cain's offering. And that's where we had a problem. Cain offering had nothing there for sin. All right? So the problem with Cain offering, it wasn't that God said you can't offer fruit or you can't offer things from the ground. That's not what the scripture says. Cain offering had nothing in it to give repentance or to confess his sin. And it was an incomplete offering, one, and it was a self-righteous offering. So the Bible says God has no respect unto Cain and his offering. But Abel, look at verse 4. And Abel, he also brought at the firstling, at the flock, and at the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect. So, Cain brought an offering from the fruit of the ground unto the Lord. Abel brought the things that Cain brought, plus first fruit, firstling. That's what is here. So the word also in the King James here, it means Cain brought in addition to the fruit of the ground. He brought the firstling. These firstling honor God by first fruit, and it honor God by what? Having blood there to atone for his sin. So Cain got upset. Not because Abel did him anything wrong, but Abel was accepted by God. And that's how some people sometimes they envy, jealous you, and sometimes fight you, trying to kill you to take what God give you because you obey God. It's a plan of the devil. Alright, so let's go on now. I'm going to go a little deeper now by skipping over some verses, and we go to Exodus 13 now. We go to Exodus 13. Exodus 13. That's where we're going at this time. Exodus 13. Everybody should remember Exodus 12. Exodus 12 has what is called the killing of the firstborn in Egypt. Exodus 12 has the killing of the firstborn. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. So Israel as a nation, they were in Egypt, and God said, I am going to kill all this firstborn of Egypt, because Israel is my firstborn, and I tell Pharaoh to let my firstborn go, let my son go. Pharaoh refused, so God said, I will kill his son, his firstborn, because he holds captive my firstborn. Watch this now. After that, in Exodus 13, God says, Exodus 13, God says in verse 2, sanctify unto me all the firstborn, all the firstborn. Sanctify, set apart unto me all the firstborn. Whatsoever openeth the womb among the children of Israel, both of man and of beast, it is mine. Underline that, highlight it. God say, it is mine. Okay? So if God say it is mine and you don't give him, what does that imply? It implies that you are what? Can a man rob God? God said, it is mine. And therefore, if it is mine, God says it must be given to me. Bear in mind, when you go further down, God does not demand and did not demand that they sacrifice their children on the altar. I'm going to tell you what God demanded and said. Still, chapter 13. Exodus 13. 1, 2, 3, 13. All right, very, very important. Let's skip down to Exodus 13, verse 12. For those who don't have a Bible handy, I'm going to put up the Bible now. This screen is coming up, and we're going to put it up now. All right, look at verse 12. That thou shalt set apart unto the Lord all that openeth the matrix. This word is called matrix. I'm going to talk about it. And every firstling that cometh of a beast which thou hast, the males shall be the Lord's. And every firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb. And if thou wilt not redeem it, then thou shalt break his neck. And all the firstborn of man among thy children shall thou redeem. So I'm going to explain that quickly for us. Exodus 13, verse 30. There it is. But we read from verse 12. God says, everything that opened the matrix. This is our word yesterday, matrix. The matrix. So it's a old word. The matrix talk, it said everything that openeth the matrix or the womb in some translation. God says that which is at the beginning of the system, the beginning of the crop, the beginning of the business, the beginning of that. God said whatever openeth, the first that comes out of the opening or the establishment. God said, every firstling that cometh of the beast, firstborn, firstborn of the animals is mine. And God said, the firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb. The firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb. Why God tell you to redeem the ass with a lamb? The ass or the donkey, we will say, is an unclean animal. That animal that is unclean cannot be offered as a sacrifice unto God. Cannot. It is forbidden because the animal cannot be eaten, therefore you can't offer it to God. So God says, what you're going to do now, in order to have the donkey, you can redeem the donkey with a lamb. In other words, give me a lamb instead of the donkey. And God said, the donkey is the firstling, you know, I'm my donkey. But you can redeem the donkey with a lamb. And if you will not redeem it, then thou shalt break his neck. God said, you can't use my donkey. You can't ride it. You can't use it in your field to do nothing. I'm my donkey. And if you don't want to redeem it by giving me a lamb, God said, put the donkey to death and bury him. Since you now give me an offering in the donkey place, kill it. And you lose, and me lose. God said, for me, you now have no permission to use the donkey. Since you can redeem the donkey and have the donkey for yourself because you give me a lamb instead. But if you don't want to do that, God said, all right, break its neck. And all the firstborn of man among thy children thou shalt thou redeem. In other words, God says, the firstborn child in your house, the firstborn child belongs to the Lord. And God says, they are not going to be given to me an altar to burn and to kill like Baal. But you are going to redeem them. You are going to sacrifice an animal in their place at the given time. That's what this is saying. Because God doesn't teach in any shape or form human sacrifice, as some cult did in the Old Testament, and Satan is still doing to our children in our time, killing them off and into satanic rituals and other stuff that are happening underground and in secret. We have to pray that are the children that goes missing, the enemy kill them for certain reasons, sacrifice their blood and so on. And in a certain cult, and I heard about this deliverance thing that people want to get rich and want to go high into certain powers of darkness. One of the things that they will ask for, I am told by those who studied it and run away from it, that one of the things that they would have asked for is something special to you. One of your children, the special one, the best one, the one you love the most, to prove that you are making a good sacrifice. And a lot of children gone missing, and it is done because the parents are living a contrary life. Okay, let me go a little deeper now. This is what you need to bear in mind now about these things. So I'm going to give you some words now that you need to bear in mind as we go a little deeper. So you notice the first fruit. Let me switch the screen just in case there are questions coming. So you notice something here. I'm going to give it to you now. Anytime you take what belongs to God, you curse yourself. So there are over 6 different Hebrew words for curse and 3 different Greek words for curse. I'm going to talk about just 2 of those Hebrew words for curse. Just 2. I'm going to talk about just 2. The first one is A-R-A-R, Arar, Arar. So I'm giving you this because of what first fruit is. And you're going to find out a little deeper as you go along. Arar. This word is the most common word in the Old Testament for curse. This word means to utter a wish of evil against, to call for a mischief or injury to fall upon somebody. So that is by word. So you offer a wish evil against or to call for mischief or injury upon somebody. That is curse. Ara. Another meaning of the word ara means to bind with a spell. To bind with a spell. Or to cast a spell upon. That's why sometimes you say, why this person, they are under spell. Because they don't want to go, they don't want to do, but they just find themselves under some compulsion to do things that they don't want to do. And then they know, say they're not supposed to do it, but them still do it. A lot of time, it is not just sinners, Paul say, have me captive. Sometimes is people put them under spell. Sometimes the man knows, say, him work, he mustn't go gamble, he mustn't give away his money to other people, he mustn't this, he mustn't that, but he does it anyway. And at the end of the week or the month, he goes home, have nothing for him wife, nothing for him family, because, well, he get paid and it gone. Lend it out, squander it out, under curse, under spell. The next word is the more important word which we are going to look at now. The word is C-H-E-R-E-M, Kerem. Pronounced Kerem. The C-H, pronounced like a K. Just like it's a character. Character, C-H-A, K. Same way, Kerem. Kerem, which is the next word for curse. This is the word in the Bible. We are going to go there now. But me giving you the definition first. This word is what is called devoted, the accursed thing, the devoted thing. That's what we're going to look at after this. So, the kerem is called the accursed thing or the devoted thing. The accursed thing or the kerem, it is one of two things. It's either it is devoted to God or it is devoted for destruction. Two things. A kerem item, a kerem things, is devoted to God to be kept, or it is devoted to be destroyed. One of two things. If you keep a kerem thing for yourself, it brings a curse upon you. All right? That's what happened in Joshua chapter 6. Let's go to Joshua 6 now, that we can explain kerem. Joshua 6, I think it is verse 18 and 19. So if the thing is kerem, it is set aside, or it's an accursed thing. If you take it for yourself, you curse yourself. Or if it is supposed to be destroyed and you keep it, you curse yourself. That's what kerem is. It is either devoted to God or it is devoted to destruction. Let's look at Joshua 6, verse 18 and 19. Let me give you the background. The Israelites are going to destroy Jericho. They are going to march around the wall of Jericho. Jericho is the first city they conquered when they entered the land. Jericho is the first city. Therefore, whatever is first belongs to who? Can I hear that? Whatever is first belongs to the Lord. So God says, clear as day, and ye, verse 18, sorry, let me skip. Let me give you the scripture. And ye in any wise, keep yourself from the accursed thing, the kerem thing, lest ye make yourself kerem. When you take the kerem thing and make the camp of Israel kerem, same root word, and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and the vessels of brass and iron are consecrated, kerem, same word, consecrated to the Lord. Kerem unto the Lord. they shall come into the treasury of the Lord. If you take it for yourself, like Achan did, it cursed the camp, and it cost Achan his life, and oh my God, the life of his wife and children. Let's go to chapter 7 quickly. We're not going to spend a lot of time of God. Everybody know about Achan in the camp. There's all there Christians who don't know about Achan in the camp. When we don't know who Achan and what Achan's about, we always hear about, boy, anytime there's any trouble in the church, we say, Achan in the camp, hallelujah, Achan in the camp. So it has become a phrase that anytime somebody in the church living contrary, living hypocritical life, sneaking and doing wrong on the quiet, and causing the church to be bearing bad name, we always say, Achan in the camp. Somebody call themselves Christian, living in disobedience and bringing the church into disrepute. So, but the children of Israel committed a trespass in the Kerem thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took off the Kerem thing. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. Everybody know that. And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai. Now, let me give you the background to this one. When they took Jericho in chapter 6, Achan took the Kerem, the accursed thing, and carried home. They still got the victory because God promised them the victory. So they got the victory. Achan carried home some of the things that were Kerem, dedicated to go into God's temple, and then carried where? I am yard. Look what happened to Achan later on. So when they went to Ai, Ai was a small city in verse 2. So Joshua did not send a lot of men to Ai because Ai was a small city that could easily be conquered, because once you go in obedience, you will win. But Joshua didn't ask God about Ai, no. He just continued to Ai. And when they went there, the people of Ai gave them a beating. Ai gave them a beating, and I think they lost 36 men. And Ai, the men of Ai, smote of them about 36 men. That is verse 5. For they chased them from before the gate even unto Shebarim, and smote them in the going down. Therefore the heart of the people melted and became as water. They could not understand. Why could we overcome Jericho? Shouting and the wall came down. And little Ai, which is small, and them don't have any military power over us, them beat we. And a matter of fact, they not only beat us in the war, they killed 36 men. And the thing about it, which is sad, you see, you notice that the man where take the Kerem, Achan, in going to the war and come back home alive. He came home alive, but him have him there come. His day came, and watch now. Joshua went to God and said, God, go on. And God said, I'm trying to run fast, so I'm skipping out. Therefore, verse 12, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their back before their enemies, because they were accursed. Neither will I be with you anymore, except you destroy the accursed from among you. So God said to Joshua, verse 11, Israel has sinned. They have also transgressed my covenant which I command them, for they have taken even of the accursed thing, and have stolen and dissembled also, and they put it even among their own stuff. Let's go down further now and see where going here. So see, Achan, you know, so Joshua have to search the camp to find out who wrong. When it came now to Achan says, When, verse 21, when I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment and 200 of shekels of silver, we're supposed to go in a God temple, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, we're supposed to go in a God temple, the Kerem thing. Then I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent messenger, then they ran into the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. No, brethren, this question is so hard. Let me see if I can show you what is hurtful about this. We found out here. Wow, my mouse is running out of battery. So we found out here that Achan sinned, and then I'm trying to find a particular verse. Wait, is it a verse? And they took them out of the tent in the midst of it, and brought them to Joshua. I'm at verse 23. And unto all the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor, and they stoned them and killed them. Now, may I ask the question? Let me say, hold on. Something look funny here. One man sinned, but in the end, his sons died, his daughters died. Nothing is mentioned of no wife. She may not be alive at the time, etc. His oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had. And they brought them to the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why art thou trouble Israel? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones, and burned them with fire, after they had stoned them with stones. Brethren, it is so sad. Notice now, one of the reasons why the children died as well, is this. There is no way Achan could have come back from war and go into the little tent that they live in and dig hole in the tent where they live in, and nobody no notice. He dug the hole in the middle of the tent and put those things under in the hole and cover it up in the house. So one of the reasons why I believe that the children died too is not just because Achan sinned, but because they must have known about what he did, and nobody said anything. So they were all stoned, because nobody dig a hole in their tent for no reason at all. So when war ended and daddy came home and him start digging a hole, somebody asked, daddy, where you digging this hole for? Where go on and where you put in there? Where you do? And he must have said to them, boy, I'm going to get some stuff. So nobody mustn't talk. I'm assuming now, so no quote me. So he must have made some arrangement, because once you get home from war, your children live in the tent, your family live in the tent, and therefore, if you're going to dig to hide something, somebody must know. They must have been aware of what he did. And therefore, they not say nothing to Joshua. They not report the crime that Achan did. And therefore, his sin that was endorsed by them cost them their life. But the animals outside might say, but what we do? See, the animals outside died too. Because God said, everything that belonged to this man, he brought a curse to us. We are going to deal with him. Now, so the issue now about this is that Jericho was first fruit. Jericho was first fruit. When they went to Ai, and they raided and they plundered, what they got in Ai, they took home for themselves. Because God demands what is first, and then they could have the rest. All right? Glory be to God. Let me see if there's any question on this chat before I go any further with what we are looking at here. Glory to God. Let me see if there's any question, because I'm going to go into some other verses right here, right now. So the key about first fruit and the feast now. So we're going to talk about some other part of first fruit now. So let's go now. So the feast of first fruit, it comes once a year. But remember now, when you have crops, right? When you have crops in the field, you are reaping at several times. So if you plant orange, if you plant dashi, if you plant banana, anything that you bring to harvest, if you have goat, you have sheep, you have that, once it is the first, once you are reaping, the first belong to God. That's what this is saying. So apart from the feast of first fruit, right throughout the year, when God give you a breakthrough or God give you an increase, the Bible says in Proverbs 3, honor the Lord with thy substance. Proverbs 3, 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with thy substance and the first fruit of all thine increase. First fruit of all thine increase. All right? Let me look up and see if there's any question, then I can finish up the discussion on this thing. All right. I don't see any question as yet. So let me go a little further on this issue of first fruit that we need to understand. The next thing we need to look at now is this. First fruit belongs to God. And we are not living now. Everybody is not doing agriculture. Some of us still do agriculture. Fine. But most of us, we get weekly pay, or we get fortnight pay, or monthly pay. So what persons are trying to ask is there anywhere in the Bible that demands that we give first fruit? Remember, we established that the first fruit belongs to God, and if you take it for yourself, you can bring a curse upon yourself. The next thing I need to bring to you now is first fruit. I want to give you some more verses. The first fruit is very, very important. So we go to Exodus 22. I'm going to explain in the next minute. Exodus 22, 9, 29 and 30. Exodus 22, 29 and 30. Thou shalt not delay to offer the first of thy ripe fruits and of thy liquors. The firstborn of thy sons shalt thou give unto me. Likewise thou shalt do with thine oxen and with thy sheep. 7 days it shall be with the dam, and the eighth day thou shalt give it to me, because God said it's mine. Now, what's the difference between first fruit and tithe? Let's talk about that quickly. What's the difference between first fruit and tithe? If you remember the clip I just played a while ago, you would have learned what first fruit is different from tithe. The gentleman says, when he reap the first fruit crop, or the first crop on the fourth year, he took the best of the lemon. Because the first fruit is the first that ripe, But sometimes when the things are ripe, some of them no good. So him say he took the best and wrote on it, first fruit, and guess what? Him saying, carry to church and put on the offering plate. My goodness. If these things are done in these days, some people are quarrel and say, oh, yeah, drop other things on the offering plate. But he brought it. And he says, he tithed from the tree. He gave the first fruit, then he tithed. Ah. First fruit is 100%. And tithe is 10%. Understand the difference now. It is all the first fruit that belongs to God. But God says, when you reap the first fruit, bring the best of it, or the sheaf of it. Because when you reap the first crop, sometimes, even though it is first crop, some of it not good. It is of substandard. So what they normally do is to go through and bring the best that they can find from all that is first fruit. And they give it to God. The all of it belong to God. The first, all of it belong to God. Now, when the tree or the animals continue to breed and to multiply, whatever you get from that, then you tithe. The first fruit is 100% of the first, and then you tithe from the remainder. So you don't give first fruit and tithe. You give first fruit, and as the crop come in later, you tithe. So you don't take the fruit and say, this is first fruit, and this is tithe. No. Once you give in first fruit, it is all of that first. That is first fruit. Then you give tithe from the rest. All right? Let me help you to understand what some people do for first fruit. Now, whenever I share on first fruit, I try to be fair to people. I try to let persons do things of their own free will and as the Lord lead them. So let's translate. We're not doing agriculture no more. Most of us, we get paycheck, pay stub, etc. Now, some persons teach that the first check you get for the year, which would be a January check, is your first fruit check. And if you're giving first fruit, they expect that on January every year, persons are going to give the whole check, or they challenge them to give half of the check, or whatever. Some persons challenge them, but if you don't give the whole check, you're not honoring God with the first fruit, because the first check for the year is the one you get in January, and you should give all of that at first fruit. They're not asking how you're going to pay rent. They're not asking how you're going to send your children to school. They're not asking how you're going to feed the family or pay a light bill. If you're not paying rent, you have other expenses to take care of. They don't ask that. Then treat the first paycheck as what? First fruit. And make you feel like you're sin if you don't give it in its entirety. But I want to show you Bible now and help you to think for yourself. Now, if you give God the whole check, you will prosper. I am not saying you won't prosper. But I am saying when persons demand that if you don't give the whole check, you're dishonoring God. Then let me explain that to you now. So tithe mean tenth. So when I get to tithe, I'm going to explain it. So I want to keep first fruit going now. In olden days, couple years ago, not long ago, whenever you go to work for somebody, listen me carefully now. I think through these things for myself. I mean, I make the pastor tell me no nonsense. I mean, I tell my people no nonsense. No. Couple years ago, when you go to work, When you finish the day, you get the pay at the end of your day. So if you don't come back tomorrow, you won't get pay for tomorrow. So at the end of each day, you normally get paid. But after a while, person say, you know what? We can't write up paper and this and that every week and every day. So you know what? We're going to keep your pay till weekend. And some say, no, we are going to pay you every 2 weeks. And most of us know we are paid every month. So the question is, if we are still being paid when we work, every day you get paid for the day, how much of the month's salary will it be for one day? Because by right, when you go to work and get paid on the first day, the whole of the money for the first day is first fruit and I got money that. So let's get it clear. If you are going to work 5 days a week, you just get the work, and you're working, let's say you're getting day pay. The first day pay you get on the job, that first fruit, that belongs to God. How much of it? The whole of it. When you go back and you get another day pay, you don't give first fruit, that's all. You have tithe from that. So the question come back now is, when you get your pay for the month, if you were to calculate it down to per day, assuming that you are in the biblical time, because in Bible times, when you work for the day, so you remember the parable penny a day, when you don't work on the day, you get your pay. So if you convert what we're doing now to Bible time, when you don't work any day, you get the pay at the evening at the end of the day. So how much of your pay that you get for the month would equivalent to 1 day's pay? 1 day's pay, if you were in the biblical time, will be your first fruit. And then you pay tithes from the rest. Some of us can afford to give a week's pay, a 2 weeks pay, or maybe the whole month pay. But to tell somebody, because they get paid once per month, 25th of the month, to give first fruit, you have to give the entire paycheck. To convert that into Bible times, it's not accurate. It's not accurate. So I explain it back in Bible times and in modern times. And then I take modern times and get back to Bible time to get people to understand. So when I call for first fruit, people have the freedom to say, you know what? When I calculate how much a day pay will be, that is too small. Me, I will give God more than that. Fine. The more you give to God, the better. But I don't want person to feel like, boy, you are pressured and you're gone under stress. Because the way some pastor put it out, as if they forget that is not long ago people start get pay per month. And sometimes when you just get the work, you have to even borrow a little advance if you go work or borrow something from somebody if you carry your work, and when you get paid, boy, you give it back. But if you were in the Bible time, once you work one day, you get paid. That first day pay would have been your first fruit. And it is 100% belonging to God. When you go back the second day and you get another day pay, then you pay tithe and give offering from that. That's how it works. So tithe follow first fruit. Let's go again. Tithe follow first fruit. But tithe is not first fruit, because some people teach that tithing is first fruit. First fruit is different from tithe. Alright? First fruit goes first, followed by tithing. So the next thing you need to look at now, it says, honor the Lord with thy substance. Proverbs 3, verses 9 and 10. And with the first fruits of all thine increase. increase. So what I seek to do when the year starts, if I do something for the first time for the year and I get paid, I try to give that to the Lord as a first fruit. And then when I do it again and get paid, I give tithe from that. Amen? So tithe is 1/10, a tenth, while first fruit is normally the 100% that belong to God. God said it is mine. So when God said you rob me in tithes and offering, you have to understand it's not just in tithes that people rob. People rob by not giving God the other kinds of offerings that belong to him. That's what God talks about. But we're not talking about tithes now. So we're not going to Malachi tonight. But I'm just explaining to us. Now, the true meaning of first fruit is our lives dedicated, holy, consecrated to God. Jesus Christ in the New Testament fulfill the feast of first fruit. And in a modern time, God's kingdom is built by his people. And therefore, if we don't give into God's kingdom, the kingdom of God will not advance as it ought to. And our lives will not prosper as we desire to. Very important. So I'm saying there are many verses I can quote about first fruit that you need to do. And God says, in the Old Testament, God said, the first fruit, bring it to the priest. Let me give you a very important scripture. Let's go to Ezekiel 44. Ezekiel 44. This thing taking too long to change, but I'm going to try. Ezekiel 44. The blessings, the benefits of giving first fruit. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel 44. So I'm saying there are many verses about the first fruit. So I just explain them for you. And then we can just. Jeremiah, Ezekiel. Ezekiel what? 44 from verse 28. Amen. Ezekiel 44:28-30. Give me a minute. 44. All right. Let me bring up the scripture for you that we can read it together. Ezekiel 44 from 28 onwards. God talking about the priests. God talking about what the people supposed to do for the priests. Because remember now, all the offering that belonged to God, God gave it to the priests. 28, let's go. And it shall be unto them for an inheritance. I am their inheritance. And ye shall give them no possession in Israel. I am their possession. So God said, the priests, they are not going to get no land, no big this, no big that. They are going to have a special place in Israel. Yes, they're going to get land, yes. But they are not going to be in possession like everybody else. Because they are my possession. I am their possession. Verse 29. They shall eat the meat of the meat offering, the priest, and the sin offering, and the trespass offering. And every dedicated thing in Israel shall be theirs. That is what God is promising to the priests. 30. Verse 30. And the first of all, the first fruit, the first of all, the first fruits of the of all things. See, the first of all, the first fruits. That's what we are saying. The word first, there should be the best of all first fruits. And every oblation of all, of every sort of your oblations, shall be the priest. Ye shall also give unto the priest the first of your dough. When you thresh the wheat and you get flour, the first of the dough that come from the wheat after you reap it is for the priest, because it is first fruit, that ye may cause the blessing to rest in thine house. The priest shall not eat of anything that is dead of itself or torn, whether it be beast or fowl. So what Ezekiel is showing is that when you obey in the Old Testament context into the New, God said you will not only have a blessing given to you, but a blessing shall rest in thine house. So if you practice first fruit, blessing will rest, abide in your house. That's what this is saying. All right? But you have to remember, it must be done according to the Bible. And it must be done in modern time with a biblical understanding. Now, there is no New Testament verse that commands us to give first fruit the way the Old Testament people were obligated. But because tithes belong to the Lord, first fruit belong to the Lord, we celebrate the feast of first fruit and we give first fruit to God. Not because we must, but because there's an opportunity to serve, to give. And once we are in obedience, we always prosper. Can you imagine? The gentleman, he went and read the scriptures. And as a farmer, he said, I'm going to try it. He tried it, and the tree that he tried it on bear different size of lemons. Now, brethren, can you imagine have a farm that you have done that to all your lemon trees, all your mangoes, all your planting, or anything you plant in the field? You wait until the time God says you must start eat it. And when you start, you give first fruit from it. That's what I'm saying to people, you know. I'm saying to people, I did it one time. I didn't do it again from that. But maybe we could try it again. There was at one time, I said to a person, listen now, you are a farmer. Because there is nowhere in the Bible, I can't find anywhere in the Bible, that says church must have harvest once a year. Can't find it in the Bible. Because anytime your crop is ready, it's harvest. But this church structure set up that you have harvest one time per year. But watch this now. So I said to the person there and then, if your crop comes in and it's not harvest time, bring it. You may not have any money, but bring the piece of yam. Bring yam and put it on the altar. You plant yam, you plant that, bring it. And when we come to give, put it at the altar, this side here. So we had a place where they put it down. And I said, when you do that, we have persons who are here in need and so on and so forth. And we can take from there and give. And trust me, we did it a little while and it was a blessing. Because people felt that, hey, I can still give to God and feel good. And I may never have any cash. Because I have a farm. I am not selling from the farm at this time. But some of the things that are on the farm ready. I may not have to go on market yet because I don't have market time yet. But I could find something on the farm and I brought it and put it on the altar. And at the end of that, we bless it and everything. And then we can find shut-ins and other persons who need a package. And we did it. I'm saying, if you try something like that in the modern time, it can work in one sense, but people rather you sell it and just bring the cash, come and we just call it a day. Because sometimes we can't bother with the quote-unquote hackling. It's not hackling because, well, in the Old Testament time coming down, there wasn't any, quote, cash. So persons never have the opportunity to, quote-unquote, go sell it and get the money and bring come. They sold things, but God tell them to bring the crop as it is. And the priest would take it home, feed him family, feed him children, and have to give God thanks. Amen. So let me go now and look if there's any other question under this one so that I can see what I can answer before we get off the air at this moment of time. All right. So here we go. Okay. Is this asking, so he might have missed it. So let me summarize now. There are two things about first fruit that I am going to summarize. The feast of first fruit, the feast of first fruit comes one time per year. And that time per year would fall on the day we call Easter Sunday or Resurrection Sunday. That's one. That's when the Bible designate first fruit, feast of first fruit, that day. Remember now, during the Passover, we have barley harvest. So you get barley harvest. At Pentecost, they give first fruit of wheat. And in the fall, during the time of Feast of Tabernacle, they gave first fruit of what? Grapes, pomegranate, and all of those fruit that Israel has. So three main times a year they give first fruit, but it's only one time a year that they have what is called the feast of first fruit. So the next side now is this. Whenever the crop that you plant is ready and you start to reap, then you have a first fruit from the crop that you are reaping to give to God as first fruit. And that can happen right round the year. You don't have to wait for the start of the year to do that. What some people do in modern time is that when they reap the first fruit, they sell it. If you go to market or the business market, they sell it. And then they bring that money for the portion of the first fruit and give it in the envelope as first fruit. That can work. But the issue is that first fruit is right around the year. So if you plant yam, you plant banana, you plant dashin, you plant cocoa, you plant orange, you plant mango, these things don't come in at the same time. So when yam is ready, you give first fruit from yam. When oranges are ready, you pick oranges and you give first fruit of orange. So as the crops come in, you give from that crop your first fruit. It's like sometimes persons are doing more than one jobs. You get a new work. When you go on that job, you give from the first earning of that job your first fruit. And when you go back or you continue, you give what is called the tithe and regular offering from that job. That's how I seek to practice it and teach. Because right throughout the year, sometimes you're getting money from several sources. You have a little money over there, so I come in for that. You do something over there, so for that. So when all of these things come in first, the first time them come in, especially during the year, then you give God a first fruit from that. And right throughout the year, when it repeats itself, you give God tithes from that. So all tithes can be put together into one thing and just give. And then the first fruit comes as the things are ready. That's how it is according to the Old Testament into the New Testament. So giving first fruit is a blessing. Okay? And the Bible teaches that there are three designated times per year that we give sacrificially. I mean, I've not taught it to us yet. You may have heard it taught, I don't know. But three times a year, God says, we must bring a special offering to the house of God. Three times a year. You can bring special offering any other time you want, but God designated three times a year that you bring special offering. And God says, when you come those three times, no one is to come empty-handed. Let me give you those three times, and then we close. We hit 9:30 already. So let me give you those time and then we close. Go to Exodus 23. Exodus 23. Exodus 23. Three times a year, God says, we must give Exodus 23. You there, say amen. Exodus 23. I want us to read it together, so I'm bringing it up on the screen. Exodus 23. Exodus 23 and verse 14. And it is also in Leviticus 23. It is in Leviticus 23 as well. But let me read this one for you. 3 verse 14. All right. Three yearly feasts. Three times thou shalt keep a feast unto me in the year. Thou shalt keep the feast of unleavened bread, which we talk about during Passover time. Thou shalt eat the unleavened bread 7 days, as I command thee, in the time appointed in the month of Abib, for in that it came out of Egypt. And none shall appear before me empty. See there? And no one who comes to that feast during the Passover time and first fruit must come empty. Everybody must bring a special offering at that time. And the feast of harvest, the first fruit of thy labors, which thou shalt have sown in the field, and the feast of ingathering, which is in the end of the year, when thou hast gathered in the labor at thy field. Three times in the year all males shall appear before the Lord. And when you appear, you must not appear empty-handed. Oh Lord, forgive me. I should have shown in the screen with the verses, but I read it. All right, Leviticus 23. That one, give us, so you are going to see the Leviticus 1. Forgive me for that one. Leviticus 23. I'm putting it up that I can read off the verses and you don't see it again. In Leviticus 23, which is the last portion that we are going to read and then close. Leviticus 23. And then it is verses 37 and 38. 23. Leviticus 23. Verses 37 and 38. God speaking now. God speaking now. And he says, these are the feasts of the Lord, which he shall proclaim to be holy convocation. 37. Come on. Why are you waiting so long? All right. 37. All right, let's go. These are the feasts of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocation, to offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord, a burnt offering, a meat offering, a sacrifice, a drink offering, everything upon his day, beside the Sabbath of the Lord, and beside your gifts, and beside all your vows, and beside all your freewill offering, which you give unto the Lord. When you study, it means your regular tithes, you still give it. Your regular offering, you still give it. But beside all of those things that you normally give and your vow you normally give, God said, bring a special, different offering at that time, during that period of time. Three times a year, God said, you meet, and when you come, you don't come empty-handed. And when you do come, you bring something special unto the Lord as a freewill offering. Nobody should tell you how much to bring in terms of finance. You are to look into your life, what God bless you with and what you can afford to bring. As the Lord lead you, so bring. Brothers and sisters, it may sound funny, but if the church get back to the principle of giving, we don't have to worry ourselves, boy, for barbecue and barbie this and barbie that and barbie that. We can give. We can give. I say to people that sometimes people say, boy, can you support? Yes, I won't be able to eat the food, but I will pay. Because what? When we learn that you give towards the worthy cause, or you give towards the kingdom, you can't lose. So God said, bring the offering, set it aside. And if you want, we can talk a little more about that. Amen. Because come first fruit during March, we can bring an offering to the Lord at that time. Any more question that may be there, I'm going to look. And if I can get it answered, then we answer it and pray. And then we will be on our way until the next time. Okay. So that was it, Brother Thompson. Those are the designated time. All right. So let me give you the time again. During Passover, the Feast of First Fruit, we call it Good Friday, Easter Sunday. That's one designated time during the year for first fruit. The next time is Pentecost. Church number Pentecost. When we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit. That's the time number two. The third time is a time that most churches don't know, nor remember, nor interested. It's called during the Feast of Tabernacles. During the Feast of Tabernacles, it normally come at the ending of September, going into October. So whenever the Jews are celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles, that's the third time that we come before God with a special offering beside the regular tithes and giving that we have. And God promised to bless the people who obey that. Amen? So let us pray. Father, we thank you for the lessons on first fruit. God, everything that belongs to you, we want to be honest with ourselves, because there's no way we can prosper living in disobedience to the word of God. There are those who try to find all that they can find to keep back and not to give. But we are reminded by our Lord that it is more blessed to give than to receive. So God, we pray that you help us to give freely, joyfully, oh hallelujah, and give, oh God, bountifully. For the word of God says you love it a cheerful giver. So Lord, as we give, we thank you that the more we give in obedience is the more you bless us to have more to give. Have your way, Almighty God, upon the audience. We pray for those who are going to be listening at a later time, that the teaching that we have put forth today will be a blessing, and that those who are going through witchcraft and going through persons pressuring them to give in a way that is not biblical, that they will learn how to give to honor God and to prosper in Jesus' name. Father, we commit everything to you, and we say thanks in Jesus' name. We say Amen. And now may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the Heavenly Father, the faithful fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, rest, remain, and abide with us as we all say amen and amen. Glory to God. So what I'm going to do as we go, remember, if you are new to the channel, subscribe to the channel, amen, click the bell icon, and that you will get all the notifications and the recordings as we teach. So the next time we come, we are going to start tithe. Old Testament perspective, New Testament perspective, what is the tithes, how you give the tithes, different things about the tithes. That's what we're going to be looking at, God's willing, come Wednesday. By His grace, study, look, find out where in the Bible tithes start, who is the first person mentioning about tithe. The question I must try to answer, is tithe under the law? Was tithe done away with when Christ died? Those are some of the questions people are going to ask. Is tithe still applicable in New Testament times? Look at those questions, and we're going to answer them, God's willing, when we get back together. I'm going to play the first fruit clip again, and at the end of it, we will be fully out of here by the grace of God. By the grace of God.
Eight years ago, I planted the lemon tree in my yard, and we were reading the Old Testament. And what it says is the first 3 years, you're not to harvest the crop. But the fourth year, you harvest the crop, and then you give the first fruits to God. Now, the fourth year on that lemon tree had 12 lemons. So I took the best lemon, and I washed it, and I took my pen, and I wrote first fruits on that lemon, and I took it to church on Sunday, and I dropped it in the offering. Okay, now 4 years later, our other tree still produces regular-sized lemons, but the tree we tithed on now produces only this size lemons. It doesn't produce any medium size or small lemons. It only produces these. God's word is true. Man, He says that He'll give you the desire to obey Him and the power to do what pleases Him. And man, this is just a result of obedience. Man, try and see.
Shalom, everybody. God bless you. Pastor Ivy here, tuning out until next time. God's willing. Amen and amen and amen. God bless you. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Having problem with my mouse? Okay.